I guess I grew up in an environment that was very heavily influenced by an extreme religious group.
Are we talking about a cult?
People have used that word, and I definitely like to use that word.
When you reflect on that time in your life, what was it like growing up in an environment like that?
One of my friends actually summed it up to me. She said, you know, we were never allowed to say no to a man. And I think, unfortunately, that had huge ramifications for me later in my life.
Sarah was 21 when she managed to leave the group, but some of its teachings stayed with her.
I ended up in a string of relationships that were, I think, problematic. I had to do whatever a man told me to do. I didn't know anything about consent. I didn't know that I could say no to things. And in my case, there was quite a lot of financial stress that resulted from that situation.
By day, she was a nurse. By night, a dancer.
I had about $20,000 worth of debt, which doesn't sound like a lot, but to me it sounded like it was going to bury me for the rest of my life.
How did you end up in the sex industry?
I was working at the strip club at the time, and we were going through a bit of a lull, and one of the girls started talking about this opportunity of working for this guy. She was like, oh, he'll set you up, he'll, you know, he'll keep you safe, he'll... And I thought having someone help me do this would be a good thing.
And when did you realise that something was wrong?
I think there were probably some red flags at the start, but I was too desperate and blinded to kind of notice them.
Was there a point when you realised that he was in control of your life, of your existence?
It changed quite gradually. The guilt trip started. There was a lot of belligerent phone calls telling you that, you know, oh, you know, you don't even care about me, you know, you girls are all selfish, you know, all of these kind of psychological things. And then eventually it became really hard to say no to any kind of work because you knew you'd kind of pay for it for hours or days or weeks even.
And there's almost always, you know, someone in the audience that will say, well, why didn't she just leave?
He made us feel like we owed him for giving us this work because he said that, you know, we had to buy that out because of all the work that he'd invested and the loss that it would be to him if we left.
And did you know how much it would cost you to buy yourself out?
I'd observed somebody else being told that it was $10,000. When I eventually plucked up the courage to ask to leave, he upped it to $25,000 for me.
Can you describe what it is like when you're in it and you know you can't actually get out?
I think I just felt like I was owned by someone. I didn't have any choice about my own life anymore, about, you know, I couldn't voice needs, feelings, or if I did, there were big consequences to that.
Though Sarah did have contact with the outside world and was paid for bookings, she says she was trapped because she was led to believe her income was dependent on her perpetrator. She was coerced into some forms of sex work that she wasn't comfortable with. There was abuse and assaults that made her feel unsafe. And ultimately, she was obliged to keep her employer constantly informed of her whereabouts.
It took me months to kind of understand that the part that manipulation and coercive control had played in this and the guilt that he made me feel for even wanting to leave. And then obviously added things like drugs, alcohol, debts to pay off, and physical violence kind of make all of those things more scary and difficult to actually try and leave.
Sarah says she eventually managed to talk to a lawyer about her situation.
I mean, it was at that point that the lawyer first used the words debt bondage and trafficking, which I didn't know anything about. I kind of thought that trafficking was only something that happened to people that were sort of kidnapped on the street and chained up in a basement somewhere. I didn't know that it could happen in different ways. I think the word slavery comes with a lot of shame, and it just seems like this unbelievable thing that you'd think would never happen to you.
Do you accept now that you were enslaved?
I still choke on the words a bit, definitely. I think the thing about it is that I'm probably more comfortable with words like exploitation and stuff like that, but I think we do need those words to have the gravity that they do because the impact of this situation has been catastrophic in my life.
Modern slavery is when one person treats another as their property. That includes forced marriage, forced labour, and sex trafficking.
Here in Australia, we think there are perhaps as many as 41,000 people in modern slavery.
James Cockayne is the first anti-slavery commissioner to be appointed in Australia and the second in the world.
It's clearly very hard for people in these situations to come forward and get the help that they need. According to the Australian Institute of Criminology, only 20% of people are presenting.
For a long time, I felt like you know, going through a reporting process would be really traumatic, but I decided to do it in the end because it was really important to me that my silence didn't enable this person to continue to do what he was doing and that it might happen to someone else.
This is a human rights crisis here in our country right now, in our midst, hidden in plain sight. It's in our power to do something about this, but we have to get moving.
Sarah is now part of a survivor's council, advising the anti-slavery commissioner.
I had to watch a lot of the people around me suffering and bad things happening to them, and I wasn't able to protect them. Sorry. So reclaiming my voice now is not just for me, it's also for them.
They're incredible stats, right? 10,000 modern-day slaves in Australia right now, and listening to Sarah speak, she had physical freedom, but she was still shackled by the emotional manipulations, by threats of violence, and also the huge debt that she had hanging over her head. And she even said herself that she didn't really feel like she was a slave.
She's never told that story in public. That's the first time she's sort of spoken about it. It's only in recent, you know, times that even those around her have come to know and understand what she's gone through. So incredibly brave human.
Absolutely, yeah.
But, you know, as you say, those figures point to the fact that she's not alone and there is a really important reason for her to tell and share that story.
Yeah. And if you or someone you know might be at risk of modern slavery, you can call the Australian Federal Police on 131 237 or report through their website. The Red Cross is also a great support resource and you can find all the details on our website.